Welcome to a new video. Today I'll be talking about the thinking skills of analysis and synthesis. Let's get started. These are some of the very common problems that I hear from learners, students, and parents. Something like, hey, I'm not very clear with my concepts, or I know the concepts, but I don't know how to apply it. I vaguely grasp a little thing, but I'm not sure how they're connected. You know, and if it stops with that, it's absolutely all right. Problem is when we take it to the next step and say, hey, I don't think it's my cup of tea. What if all these symptoms have a much deeper root cause, which can be solved by understanding how thinking works? Let's get started. This is a chess puzzle. It's specifically a checkmate puzzle. If you want, you can pause this video here and try to find the solution. This is another puzzle. In this, we need to checkmate the black king. Again, you can pause the puzzle here, the video here, and try and solve the puzzle. Let's go to the next one. This is another puzzle. In this case, black is supposed to checkmate the white king. You can pause the video again and try and solve this puzzle. Now, I'm not sure whether you tried to pause and solve it, or maybe you spent a few seconds or even a minute to look at all the three puzzles. These three puzzles are of increasing levels of complexity, and I can keep going on by increasing the complexity of the puzzle in different dimensions. But how does one solve puzzles like this, right? And this is just a stand-in. Chess is just a stand-in. A similar, you know, set of puzzle can be ordered in terms of complexity in math, in science, in physics, in music, in dance. It doesn't matter. In any field, complexity of what the task is, the problem that you're trying to solve, can always keep increasing. I hope you get the point. And this is where I want you to focus on today's topic, which is analysis and synthesis. In simple words, analysis is breaking things down, and synthesis is building things up. And both analysis and synthesis skills are very important if you would like to do any kind of creative work or complex problem solving. That's all theory, well and good, but let's try and apply it. Let's take the puzzle that I had shared. How does one solve a puzzle like this? Now, it's quite possible that you got the answer, but it's the reason of how you got the answer that's kind of important, because a lot of puzzles can be solved out of habit. It can be solved out of pattern recognition. It could be solved out of sheer serendipity. You just saw the move and it kind of popped in your head, intuition, which is all great when things work, but when things don't work, when you're struggling, you know, maybe you got the first puzzle right, but not the second or the third. Maybe you got the first two right, but not the third. What is the skill that you need to solve the puzzle that seems unsolvable? And that is my focus. So the first step is to learn how to analyze. In other words, how to break things down. So let's get to the very brass tacks of it. So what is a checkmate? We know this puzzle is about a checkmate. So what is a checkmate? Checkmate is basically the fulfillment of two conditions. The first condition is there has to be a safe check. An attack on the king is called a check. And if there is no attack on the king, then it could be a stalemate or it could be something else, but definitely not a checkmate, because a checkmate pre-requires The prerequisite of a checkmate is that there has to be a safe check. The second condition is that on giving that check, the opponent king shouldn't be able to escape to any square, right? So these are our basic understanding. We've broken down checkmate into these two pieces. Now let's try and apply it. So condition one is I need to give a check. So I have to wonder who is going to give the check. You know, which black piece is going to give the check? Obviously, it can't be the king. Way too far, as well as theoretically, it's not possible for one king to give a check to another king. It's definitely not any of the pawns, considering the distance from the king. It's not the bishop either, because the bishop is on the light square and the king is on the dark square. So the bishop will not be in a position to give any possible check. So who's left? The last man standing is the queen. The queen is the one that needs to give the check. So in case you didn't know how to solve the puzzle, this is how you would start off, by eliminating everything that's not possible and selecting the possible answer, saying who can give the check? It has to be the black queen. Next, let's look at the king now. You know, condition one has been taken care of. Who will give the check? Condition two, where would the king escape to? Right? And we know that he can't capture his own pawn. So those two squares are out. He can't come to the square in front of him because the bishop is controlling it. The two squares that he can actually escape to are the diagonal dark squares. Now, you could ask that, hey, both of those squares are also controlled by the queen. But remember, the queen, in order to give a check, is going to have to move away from its current square, which means one or both of these squares would eventually become the escape squares. Right? So it's very important to focus on this particular aspect. Now, you've broken down the second part of the problem, which is where would the king escape to? Now, let's go back and say, okay, we realize that the queen is going to give the check, but how is the queen going to give a check? And it's possible that queen can give a check diagonally. See, to give a check, you need a line of attack. And the king right now has three lines of attack. So we're starting with the first one. He could come here, he could come here. We're just listing down all the possibilities. Or he could go to the other side and give a diagonal check, which would be four. He could come to 5, 6, or 7. So these are the possible ways in which the queen can potentially give a check. Now, if you've seen, we have taken the problem, we have broken it down into three parts. The first one was who's going to give a check? We got the answer as the queen. The second one was where would the king escape to? It was square 3 and 4. And now we have also solved the problem of how many possible checks exist, which is 7 in total. Now, each one of them can be evaluated and said, am I satisfying condition one? Am I satisfying condition two? For example, 1, 2, 3 all have a problem. Condition one is satisfied. It's a check. But the king will have an escape square by moving to four, square number four. 5 and 6 are also with the same problem, which is there is a check, but the king can escape to either 3 or 4. 4 and 3 are very similar because it's a check and the king can't escape anywhere, but the king can capture the queen because the queen is unsupported. Thereby giving you the final answer of queen moving to square number 7 for the checkmate to happen, because then the king won't be able to go anywhere. So let's assume that queen moves to square number 7, then you basically have a check. Yes, condition 1 is satisfied. Can the king go anywhere? No, absolutely not. All the 5 squares around him is either blocked or controlled, and therefore it is a checkmate by definition. This is how certain you can be about the problem. So now, one question that you could ask is, do we need to do all of this to be able to solve it? Not really. As you solve puzzles, you would start getting really, really good at building what is called as intuition. The answer pops up. You don't need to do this amount of analysis. But the analysis is your go-to tool when you don't know how to solve it. Plus, it also is a wonderful tool to actually build critical thinking. For instance, in our class, typically we would ask our students, can you tell me, with respect to checkmating alone, what are the similarities between square 3 and 4? The similarity is that in both these cases, the queen would get captured by the king. What's the difference between square 5 and 1? When I give a check from square 1, the king can escape to 4. When I give a check from square 5, the king can escape to both 3 and 4. What's the difference and similarities between 1 and 6? The similarity is that they're both on the same vertical line, or a file as we call it in chess. The difference is that what we just discussed now, which is when I give a check from 1, the king can escape to 4. When I give a check from 6, he can escape from either 3 or 4. These kind of questions and building up on the whole puzzle is what builds critical thinking, and that's how our pedagogy in Zugzwang is developed. So let me leave you with a couple of thoughts. So what is fluid intelligence? Finding the difference between similar things and finding similarities between different things. This is the definition of fluid intelligence and intelligence. If you can train your brain to build these two fundamental skills, then you would really, really build on your fluid intelligence quotient. And finally, in order to solve a puzzle like that, you need to learn both of these skills of analysis and synthesis. And fluid intelligence is what makes you really good at analysis and really good at synthesis. I hope you like this video, and please stay subscribed, apply thy intelligence, subscribe and hit the bell icon so that I can continue to share my thoughts and the pedagogy that I have developed, which will help you build your thinking skills and your chess skills. Thank you so much.